The sun is setting on the first test of 2024, and Sepang has provided us with a few clues for the season ahead. Coming up, we promised it yesterday and the riders delivered. The lap record smashed again in Malaysia as Bagnaia and Martin renew their 2023 rivalry. But could the Bees be ready to gatecrash the title chase after a tough debut year with the Factory Ducati team? The real Enea Bastianini is back. And what are the prospects for the Japanese duo? Progress seems to be the buzzword for Honda and Yamaha. They're on the road to recovery, but how far along are they? We will try to answer that question over the next 90 minutes. Yes, this is After the Flag. The Sepang test is drawing to a close. Just under half an hour of running to go in Malaysia before everybody packs up, heads home and gets ready for two final days of pre-season testing in Qatar in a week and a half's time. My name's Lewis Sutterby. Alongside me once again is Elliot York. We're going to bring you all of the analysis and reaction over the next hour and a half from out there in Sepang, where we're starting to get a little bit nearer to knowing who's hot and who's not in the sweltering heat of Sepang ahead of the new 2024 MotoGP season. And as mentioned right up at the top, Elliot, we promised it yesterday, we were expecting the first ever 156s. We didn't just have one of them, did we?
No, four riders into the 156s now at the top of the timesheets. All of them Ducatis, it has to be said, and three of them on the 2024 spec Ducatis as well. But yeah, the times have really hotted up. And the top 10 as well, Lewis, so all under the official lap record of Pecco Bagnaia. So the factories have clearly been working hard over the winter. We did expect today that we'd see that 156 barrier broken, and we have. So exciting times. The riders have been pushing on time attacks and doing some sprint simulations as well, some longer run pace. Interesting to read into them as well. But yeah, the times have tumbled.
Yeah, we'll try and take a deep dive through the lap times for you and try and give you an idea of who's looking particularly good and maybe who is playing catch-up ahead of the Qatar test. We can head over to the Petronas Sepang International Circuit and link up for the first time this afternoon with Simon Crafar, who's out there ready to talk to us. Simon Crafar, of course, will be answering your questions during the course of this show. You've been sending them in on Instagram, and we'll be putting those to him very, very shortly. Simon, welcome along once again. First of all, just a general overview of the day, because it was an electric start to this final day of the Sepang test. It's calmed down a little bit since then, but the hard work continues. Just what has been going on as the day's unfolded?
Okay, as you expected, so did I, some real time attacks today, but I didn't quite expect the atmosphere that was here first thing this morning. The riders wanting to take advantage of the cooler track early on to do their time attacks, and it was the first time since the race at Valencia that I've felt that atmosphere, that the red light was still on and riders were lining up at 10 o'clock this morning to head out, which is not usual at a test. And then they got up to speed on an old set of tyres, all of them, and then rolled in, banged a new set in, and you really saw sometimes, like, the amazing ones all in the 56s, and then that was all done then. And the time was sort of between 10:30 and 11 that all that happened. After that, it got harder and harder. By 12 o'clock, the track temperature soared because of the sun, and it made it very difficult. Then you saw people doing, and still is actually happening now, doing long runs like sprint simulations, 10 laps, their boards going out 10, 9, 8, 7, and some amazing sprint simulation times. A lot of riders have been doing that.
Simon, lots of things going on track, of course, but one breaking news story we've had today, this morning in Barcelona, obviously this morning over in Sepang as well, was Davide Brivio is joining the paddock again at Trackhouse Racing. A great coup for Trackhouse Racing, proves how seriously they're taking MotoGP. What's your thought on Davide joining the paddock again?
Yeah, it just shows how serious that team is taking it, because how good Davide is, but also he's not going to come cheap, you know. So there, for them to want to invest in that, they want results, you know. I've known Davide I first met him properly in 94 when I joined the World Superbike paddock full time, and he was the Yamaha team manager at World Superbikes all through those Haga years. I only worked with Davide when I joined Haga 98 to ride the 8 hour, and really got to know him over that week in Japan. And he's a great guy, great communicator with an incredible history, you know. The Trackhouse to bring him on, like I said, it shows how serious they're taking it.
Yeah, couldn't agree more with that, Simon. We're all excited to see him back in the paddock once again. Thanks very much for the moment. We'll catch up with you again a little bit later on in the show. So Davide Brivio is back in MotoGP. We'll discuss Trackhouse and the Aprilia quartet in general a little bit later on. But we're going to start with Ducati, who remain the class of the field, certainly if the first 3 days of testing are any indication. And Elliot, the factory team are going to be our immediate focus, but I have to say, when we woke up this morning and took a look at the immediate early lap times from Sepang, I just got feelings of late 2023 again. Bagnaia and Martin, the battle's rejoined.
Certainly has done, yeah. The battle is rejoined between those two. Sort of what we expected coming into Sepang, isn't it? The top two from last year, hitting the ground running, early doors in Sepang. Looks like Ducati have made a significant step forward with the new package as well, which is exactly what they'd have been searching for, not what the competitors would have wanted to see so early into testing. But yeah, Ducati have clearly found a new direction with the GP24. But Lewis, more importantly, I think for the championship in general, it's Andrea Bastianini's return to form. Great to see the Beast back up there. Obviously topped the times yesterday, and it's just good to see the Beast sort of back to what we know he can do best. We heard from Davide Tardozzi earlier saying Enea's over the moon. He's back to his sort of 2022 self. Obviously, we know how Enea's year went last year. It was a disaster. Missed 9 races through injury. Only scored 1 podium. That was, of course, the win here in Sepang. So great to see the Beast joining Bagnaia and Martin, at the top of the timesheets, and Ducati looking really, really strong. But it's great to see Enea up there with his teammate and Martin.
As you can see, left-hand side of your screens, Bagnaia and Martin first and second. Bastianini and Alex Marquez there in fourth were also in the 156s. Davide Tardozzi, who we're going to hear from shortly, spoke in pre-season at the team presentation saying that Enea comes across to him as a lot more serene this year, a lot more calm, a lot more at ease with things. And I guess in some ways it's a bit of a new lease of life for him, isn't it? Because he must have gone to the final round of the season cheering on his teammate Pekka Bagnaia for a couple of reasons to win the championship, not least because it was going to preserve his place at the factory Ducati team. And I guess he'll be looking to try and prove that 2023 and the struggles he had were purely down to just a cruel lack of track time in the first half of the season, because any time it appeared as if Enea Bastianini's 2023 season was going to get up and running, another injury hit.
Yeah, through no fault of his own, obviously, in Portimao got taken out, unfortunately, by Luca Marini in the sprint. That was his shoulder blade injury, missed a few races. And then, of course, the Barcelona crash was sort of Enea's fault, went in too hot into turn one, picked up left hand and left foot injuries there. But coming into pre-season, I think he'll have been really happy to see the back of 2023. I think Sepang, really, this time, well, last year, at the Malaysian GP, where he won and finished fourth in the sprint behind Pekka, he had the pace to beat Pekka in the sprint, but played the team game. By all accounts, that probably secured him the ride for this year, with obviously how well Jorge Martin was doing. There was a lot of talk about Enea's future, and sort of rightly so, with the contrasting seasons that Bastianini and Martin had had. So for Bastianini to go and do that at the Malaysian GP was super important for him, just to sort of know going into the winter after such a difficult season, okay, I can still win. I've got the package underneath me, a few months of good training under my belt, and I'm going to be ready to go. And it's great to see that he's doing that so far.
And Enea Bastianini's sprint simulation that we saw earlier on today was very comparable with the fastest. He wasn't the absolute fastest, but he was on average within a tenth or two of a second from the very, very best. To get an overall summary then on Ducati's first pre-season test of 2024, let's get a word with their team manager, Davide Tardozzi. How happy is he with their first 3 days of running?
Yeah, I think that after 3 months with the new bike being 8 tenths below the pole position of last year's race is something amazing. But what's on top is that first, second and third are the three 2024 Desmos 16, so we are really happy about that result. I think the engineers, Gigi and his group, worked very good during the winter. The package, it seems that it works for all the riders, and that's why it makes us very happy. We have a new engine, we have a new aerodynamic and new exhaust. We start from the beginning with the 2023 bike to set up the feeling of the riders, while we pass immediately on the new bike, and slowly we introduce part of the package, and finally the three riders, as I said, appreciate all the new parts, and I think that we have now a good package to go in Qatar, where we need to test again and finalize the setting of the new bike. We are happy to have Pecco for the future. Pecco wants to stay with us. We are discussing with his management. I think that the things are going well, not finalized yet, but we would like to do it as soon as possible. We have not a target, but I think that we are very close to finalize. In 2024 is very, very difficult to think who will be on the podium from the first race and who will challenge for the championship. I think that there are at least 12 riders that can be on the podium, and it will be at least 4 or 5 riders that can win the championship. So it's a very tough competition. The opponents of Ducati are strong, and they grow up a lot during the winter. We see the progress of KTM. We are sure that Yamaha will grow very, very quick. With a very top rider like Fabio, they will be very competitive. So good for the fans.
Well, we certainly hope Davide Tardozzi is right. 4 or 5 riders he thinks can challenge for the championship. Perhaps up to a dozen could be fighting for the podium in the first race. We'd certainly sign for that. Action continues out there in Malaysia. And just a quick line to bring you. Maverick Viñales has stopped on track in the last couple of minutes with an apparent technical issue. And we spoke to him earlier on. You'll hear his interview over the course of the next 90 minutes. He was not particularly happy with his test. Certainly some cold water poured on Aprilia's pre-season optimism today in Malaysia. But coming back to Ducati, I guess the competition would have been looking at Ducati in pre-season and maybe hoping for a repeat of the early part of 2022, where they weren't quite sure what sort of engine configuration to go with. Jorge Martin and Joan Zarco ended up running the new engine. Bagnaia and Jack Miller, as it was at the time, went for a sort of hybrid of the 21 and 22 bikes. If the other factories were hoping for some signs that Ducati weren't quite certain on their direction for this year, I don't think their prayers have been answered.
No, absolutely not. They've come into sort of day one and day two. Pirro obviously did the shakedown, of course, but the three guys on the factory bikes, Franco Morbidelli, unfortunately not here. They've hit the ground running. Martin took a little bit more time to sort of test the new fairing they've got, but straight away the engine, Davide Tardozzi and the riders confirmed, yeah, we've got that nailed down straight away. They've made a step with the engine. Now Martin on day three has said, yeah, the 2024 fairing, the different aero on the side of the fairing is got a lot more potential than 2023. Pecco's super happy. We've already spoken about how Ana is over the moon in Tardozzi's words. So not the news that the other manufacturers wanted to hear, but it just proves how good of a job Ducati continue to do.
Certainly does. Of course, you heard Davide Tardozzi there speaking about the potential contract situation of Pecco Bagnaia and remains confident that they're going to come to an agreement in the very near future, whether that's before or after the Qatar GP. That one does feel like a matter of time. Of course, in terms of the Constructors' Championship last year, Ducati were at the very opposite end of the scale to Honda, who were looking to try and lift themselves off the canvas and get back in the fight at the front this year. Whether that's going to happen might well be a long-term goal rather than a short-term one. But if we look at Honda's test as a whole, which kind of takes in 6 days of testing, not just the 3 days we've had of the official Sepang test, but also the Sepang shakedown, which took place at the back end of last week, I guess within realistic expectations, Honda, will they feel they've got pretty much everything out of this test they would have looked for?
I think so. Hearing from Pooj, who I think we're going to hear from a little bit later on in the show as well, he spoke very well about how the test went. Honda have definitely made steps forward. All the riders have said that, particularly Juan Mir and Jaren Zarco are very complimentary of what Honda have done over the test. We know how bad Mir's season was last year and how disappointed he was on a lot of occasions pretty much all year. He cut a really low-key figure. But Mir is super pleased with how they've gone about their business. A lot of testing done over the three days in Shakedown. They've done two, about to complete the third one of the official test. So yeah, Honda are definitely pleased. Interesting to hear from Pooj. They're not expecting to make big gains and be a podium threat and win threat straight away, but it's about making those extra steps forward, little steps forward, progress, which is what they've done, and it's good to see. Mir has set a good time on one lap pace, which is good to see. Promising signs. Marini's taking a little bit more time, but of course Marini's used to the Ducati and not the Honda. The riders have said how well Mir is riding, and judging from Mir's interview, he's having a bit of a joke and a smile, which is good to see, because we did not see that at all last year. So promising signs. Certainly for Honda, there's undoubtedly a long way to go, of course, and they're the first to admit that, but they've made a huge step forward from the 2023 package to the 2024 bike they tested in Valencia, and then the upgraded version they've also bought to Sepang.
Yeah, Juan Mir was over a second quicker today than he was at any stage in the Malaysian Grand Prix weekend back in November. Now, of course, context is important, and track conditions perhaps slightly more favourable than they were around that time. But whatever the conditions, for Juan Mir to set a 1:57.374, be under the official lap record in Sepang, is no small achievement. Jack Gorst is out there in the Sepang pit lane for us, and he's been keeping a close eye on what Honda have been up to. And as we say, Jack, whilst, of course, it's not going to be a quick fix to get Honda all the way to the front again, it feels as if they're starting to make steps in the right direction, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. They're for sure making big progress in the right direction. We've heard that from their team managers, the riders as well. And also, we're just seeing it out on track and in the times. As you do say, Joao Mir going 1.1 seconds quicker today than what he did in Q1 at the GP here not that long ago. When was the last time you saw a factory take a step of over a second over the winter break by development alone? It's pretty incredible what they've actually done. But the trouble with Honda is they may have taken a 1.1, maybe even more step forward, but Ducati took an 0.8 step forward. So really, it's kind of like you take two steps forward and one step back. But if they keep doing that, and keep taking those big step forwards, hopefully we'll see them come to the fore. Of course, one of the big things with the new bike is that, and Joan Mir was extremely complimentary of this, and so too Taka Nakagami from the LCR squad, was just how much better the engine pickup was on the throttle connection. It was much more usable, much friendly. Last year it was really snappy, and they were struggling to hold it in a smooth, controlled manner around some of the longer corners and maintaining that rear grip as a consequence of that. This year it's much better than that, and also Alberto Pooj, I'll try that one again, did finally confirm to us as well that the bike is lighter. So that's the official confirmation there, that the bike is significantly lighter, and that has huge benefits in all sorts of areas, braking, acceleration, and also in the corners and in the twisty bits, changing it from one side to the other. Of course, on the other side of the garage, you have Luca Marini, and they've been extremely complimentary of Luca. Actually, Luca's just going out now, probably to complete a few final laps and then obviously do some practice starts at the end. They're extremely complimentary of Luca. Alberto said that he was methodical, that's the word he used. And you can really see that in Luca's style. We knew that he already was like that, but it's brilliant to see how easily he's slotted into the factory fray there and kind of the testing duties that have been bestowed upon him. We know that he knew he had the brain for that. We know as well, and he's proven it now, that he certainly does have the brain to slot into that and do exactly that. He did point out that, okay, while the Honda has made big progress, they still, of course, have a lot of work to do. We know this. But one of the big areas was still a little bit of that rear grip, but more so than that was stability with the rear end as well. Most likely that will be to do with braking in a straight line, and then also accelerating out of the corner, something that is massive in MotoGP now with the way that the rear Michelin slick tyre works. Another thing to note, of course, we'll transition over to the LCR Honda side of the Honda stable. Joan Zarco has been extremely impressive. the attitude and the mentality that he's brought to it, of course, now in the latter stages of his career, and still a handful of years left for Johann Zarco, absolutely. But it's nice to see the mentality change, because, of course, the worrying signs were that, well, when he was at KTM in this development role, perhaps he didn't handle it in the best way he could have done, but certainly seems now he is. And it's really nice as well to hear from Lucio Ceccanello earlier in our midday live that the relationship now between Honda and LCR is stronger than it ever has been. Another point that's really intriguing to me is that there seems to be much more unity in terms of just the actual physical parts on the bike. One, I think that shows that obviously Honda have genuinely found a significant step forward, and that all the riders go into this one specification of bike, because in recent seasons we've seen 2, 3, even 4 chassis, and all four riders using 4 different chassis at the same time, even on test days. And that's something that, when you're working towards one goal, maybe isn't the best way to go about it. So it's nice to see now that they're all on the same chassis, there's 2 different levels of aero, but what they have done is they've all kind of gone to this one setup. And it's intriguing, actually, because what they've done is they've, using the side pod wings from the Valencia aero, the Valencia test aero, and then they're using the top wings from the very, very latest one that Bradl first tested in Jerez in January, and then also here at the Shakedown as well. That's another point. Luca Marini pointed out that they do want more downforce from their aero as well. And they did hint, they didn't say that there would be, but they hinted at the possibility that possibly at the Qatar test we would see Honda take another step in their aero department and maybe bring an upgrade or two. We're not too sure, but we'll have to wait and see in about a week or so's time when we do arrive in Qatar for those 2 Qatar tests. But a massive step forward from Honda, there is no doubt, but still a long way to go. When the competition is striding forward like Ducati are, it's going to be hard to catch up.
Music to the ears then of Honda fans everywhere. Thanks very much, Jack, and thanks for all your contributions throughout this Sepang test, and we'll catch up with you again in Qatar in a couple of weeks' time. So Jack alluded to there the interview with Alberto Puig. We can hear that interview now. Jack caught up with him a little bit earlier on.
We realise, that we improved. Our power is clearly better, and the bike is much lighter, which was one of our targets. And also the connection from the engine, it's also improved. The steps we made are positive. We think we know where we have to improve, because in the long run we are not as strong as in the one lap. And this is probably where we have to work on. Our main target for the next test. But in terms of performance, the bike is faster, and now we have to try to make the bike more stable during the race. Well, we always work together with LCR team, and probably this year the connection is a little bit bigger. There's more people involved, and we put more resources, so we have to try to utilize the concessions as much as we can. So if we have one experience like that, like Johan in the other garage, it's good to try to give him some support. But also it's not so easy, to have all the equipments for all the riders at the same time, no? But Honda's doing, HRC is doing a big effort for it, and let's see if we can get some benefit out of all this. Professional would not be the word. He's very methodic. He's a guy that don't want to leave anything for later. So he wants to point out all the things that he feels. And his comments are really very clear. Very clear, good understanding of the bike, even though it's first time for him with the Honda. But yeah, very, very, very promising. And he comes from a bike with a high performance. And now he's understanding this machine, but he has adapted very well to the team, and yeah, we are very pleased of his efforts these days, and yeah, we are happy. We don't have to discover Johan. He's a 2-time world champion, and he struggled a lot because probably he was not matching with the bike, no? Now we improve in some areas that for him were important. The connection of the engine and the rider, it's for him, it's better. we have more power, and we will show, or he can, he will be able to show his real potential. No? So no question marks on him. Just we try to fix these things and see how it goes. Clearly, we want to get out of the area we were in the past years, which was really not 100% competitive. We are working for it, to go back to a level that it's, let's say, that our riders have the possibility to fight. And this will be the first step. And the second step, of course, is to go back to winning mode and when the bike is full ready. And finally, our only target is to win the championship and to win races. This is Honda philosophy.
Yeah, Honda aren't here to make up the numbers. They compete to win, and that is their ultimate goal, although it may take a little bit of time for them to close the gap ultimately to Ducati. It does feel as if they're making steps in the right direction, Elliot, and noticeable there were the complimentary words that Alberto Puig said regarding Luca Marini. Now, of course, the team manager's going to say nice things about his new signing. That's why he signed him, but we heard him alluding to how methodical, Jack Gorst also mentioned how methodical Luca Marini is, how clear his feedback is, how intelligent he is in terms of analysing what the bike needs and giving the team the correct feedback to try and make those steps. And all of that is exactly why they signed him.
Precisely, exactly what you said, Lewis. Exactly why they signed Luca Marini, and to the same extent, Johann Zarco. Both obviously rode the Ducati last year. Honda need all the data they can collect and info they can get from those two Ducati riders. And already you can sort of sense from what Alberto is saying that especially Luca Marini, who he's working closer with, he's saying all the right things. He's working well with the team alongside Joan Mir as well. They're forming a really good partnership. If you're judging by the times sheets, obviously Luca Marini looks like he's not setting the world alight, but he was never going to in the tests. This is for Honda and Luca Marini, especially all about getting used to the bike, building on the progress they've made in the shakedown through the Sepang test, and obviously a couple of days left over in Qatar as well. But the positive signs are certainly there. Luca sounding positive. They know which direction they need to take with the bike. He says the turning point for him especially is where they need to improve himself compared to Zarco and Joan Mir especially. So the signs are positive, certainly for Marini, and this is exactly what we expected from him. And like you said, exactly why Honda signed him from Ducati, and probably why Marini wanted to go to Honda, to challenge himself to help bring Honda back to the top.
Well, I'm sure Luca Marini has been debriefing with his team to give them all of the feedback they need about his new Repsol Honda RC213V. He also spoke to us. Let's hear what he had to say.
Luca, end of the Sepang test here just about, and it looks really positive on Honda's side. Over the last, well, 5-6 days on track, just sum up the progress that you've made.
Yeah, the feeling is positive, but still we are far away from the first. We need to improve now. We know very well the direction, especially these 3 days. With all the other riders, help us a lot for understand a little bit our potential. Also with new tires, in a race simulation, now we know where we need to work. So let's see in Qatar if we can bring something even better.
And how was the time attack this morning on your side? I know that Joan did a pretty incredible lap with a 57.3. I think you were at 58.0. I presume that was your first time really pushing for a time attack on the bike.
Yeah, exactly. This morning I tried to do my best, but still we need to find a little bit more confidence with the bike, a little bit more turning, especially in the entry phase. Joan is riding well, and he made an amazing lap, so good. It's clear that he has one more experience. I know very well in which way he need to push for make a good lap. Then in the base we are more similar, we are closer, but anyway, I think we still have a lot of work to do, because also 57.3 is not enough also this.
Yeah, incredible that it's not enough. For the Qatar test, as you say there are possibly some plans to bring some new parts there. Can you detail on what those are?
Still I don't have all the details, but sure, they will bring something interesting. See you there. Thank you so much.
Well, we will watch with interest to see what Honda do bring to the Qatar test. And of course, they do have the luxury, as we've already detailed over the first 2 days of this Sepang test, they have the luxury of concessions, of course, this year. So they're able to bring an extra aerodynamic upgrade through the season. Usually you can only use two once the season gets underway. Honda and Yamaha will have the option to bring in a third at one stage through the season. And of course, they have extra engines as well. And the development of said engines is not frozen, unlike the European manufacturers ahead of them in the order last year, including Ducati, of course. And we've already discussed Enea Bastianini, who looks like he's back on form this year. Third quickest today in the 156s, hot on the heels of Pecco Bagnaia and Jorge Martin. So how happy is the beast with his first test of 2024? Let's find out.
Enea, 3 days done here and some really impressive work by yourself and also the Ducati team. You look like you're back to riding at your best and feeling really good with the bike. How was it from your point of view?
Yeah, from my point of view, also this third day has been so nice. And, well, we have worked a lot from the start. Also today, we have made a two-time attack because it was important for me to bring the true speed also in that point. Well, I'm happy because I'm really close to the fast one, to Pecco. I have to work a little bit with the brake in the first part because I'm a little bit aggressive compared to him. But in the paces, I'm really satisfied. Also, I have tried the short race of Saturday and was good.
Yeah, I was just about to say about that sprint simulation that you did. It was really, really strong. How did you feel in those later laps as the tyre started to wear down?
Yeah, the tyre haven't worked very, very well. We have some problem also the other Ducati rider, but we have to check this one. A little bit of vibration, but the lap time was good, and we have only to understand this. This problem, but I think I don't know from what this is coming.
And Bastianini speaking there to Jack Gorst. He was third quickest then at the end of the Sepang test, which is now complete. As you can see there, checkered flag is out. There were one or two late improvements just in the closing minutes from Marco Bezzecchi, who improved on his lap time today, if not in the test overall. Brad Binder also made a late improvement. Perhaps somebody told him that over the course of today, he was not the fastest KTM. That honour did belong to Pedro Acosta once again until around about 5 minutes ago. But Brad Binder did move back ahead of the rookie that's been making the headlines so far in this Sepang test. So let's take a look then at the overall standings at the end of this first pre-season test. 3 days of Sepang test complete, 2 days of Qatar test to come, and Pecco Bagnaia, the reigning world champion, will head there fastest overall, quickest on a blockbuster 156.6. Jorge Martin second, with Enea Bastianini and Alex Marquez completing a quartet of Ducati riders in the 156s. Alex Marquez, the sole GP23, of course, in that list. Aleix Espargaró, best of the rest in fifth, ahead of Marc Márquez, showing his first signs of time attack pace on the Gresini Ducati to take sixth. From Brad Binder, Fabio Di Gianantonio, the star rookie Pedro Acosta, and Juan Mir. Fabio Quartararo was 11th, from Maverick Viñales and Taka Nakagami. Jack Miller, 14th. Marco Bezzecchi, as mentioned, did improve late on, but still unable to match the lap time he did yesterday. Alex Rins, 16th. On his first test of 2024 in Yamaha Blue. John Zarco, 17th, from Miguel Oliveira, the sole Trackhouse rider, of course, out on track in the second and third days with Raul Fernandez injury. Luca Marini, 19th, from Cal Crutchlow. Augusto Fernandez, Lorenzo Savadori, and Michele Pirro. Augusto Fernandez desperate for some progress today. In the final day of testing in Sepang, it did appear as if he found it. So practice starts to complete this test before the riders get a well-earned rest and a week off before they head to the Lasalle International Circuit in Qatar in just over a week's time. And I guess ultimately, Elliot, the big takeaway from the test is that Ducati would appear to have moved the goalposts even further. Of course, we've spoken already about Honda. We're going to discuss Yamaha shortly and their attempts to close in. KTM look to have made good progress too, but Ducati aren't exactly standing still.
No, exactly that, Lewis. We didn't expect them to stand still, of course. We were unsure how much progress they would make to build on the 2023 package that was well beaten. It's been well beaten for the past couple of years. Ducati haven't been off the podium for the last 2 years. Only didn't win three races last year. So sort of how do you make that bike even better? But it looks like they have done, and to set four 156s, three of them on the new bike, straight out of the blocks is scary times for the manufacturers. They're also making strides, but they needed Ducati really to not make as much progress as they had. They've found a few tenths of Ducati. So yeah, they'll be heading to Qatar really, really confident that they can build on that further. And there's work to do for the other manufacturers.
In terms of other names that have stood out so far in this test, a couple that sort of jump off the page for me. Fabio Di Gianantonio, I think, has had a really good Sepang test. He's appeared to have the edge on Marco Bezzecchi so far in the 3 days that we've seen. He's looked pretty good as he's adjusted to life in the very distinctive VR46 liveried Ducati. And of course, we've talked about him ad nauseum over the last couple of days, but we need to mention him again. And we'll mention him later on when we ask Simon Crafar for his thoughts on him. But Pedro Acosta once again inside the top 10 today. Pedro Acosta, a 157.365. If only he'd been in MotoGP 6 months ago, that lap time would have put him on pole position for the Malaysian Grand Prix. Pedro Acosta under the lap record and pretty much on the pace of his teammate Brad Binder. And it's one thing we have to point out, and there's an interview coming up on MotoGP.com later on today with Aleix Espargaró, who was asked about Pedro Acosta's sprint simulation, because there wasn't an awful lot between them, was there?
No, absolutely not. For Acosta to be under the official lap records after 6 days in Sepang is truly remarkable stuff. We expected him to be good, but I think most of us didn't expect him to be quite this good. Inside the top 10 at the Sepang test for your first 6 days properly on a MotoGP bike. Of course, he had that day in Valencia, but that was just sort of about getting to know the bike, using the ride height devices and the getting used to the electronics and stuff. But super, super impressive from Pedro Acosta. I think he's raised expectations that we had already as Acosta in 2023. And yeah, like you say, for Didier as well, he's been impressive. I think he was especially pleased with his race pace. So that's interesting for Didier. Now he just has to work out how to do that over one lap. I think we've got a tweet coming up.
We just saw it there, didn't we? The tweet from Tech3 regarding Pedro Acosta's sprint simulation. It's difficult to look at the lap times on the tweet there, but what that equates to is an average lap time for Pedro Acosta on his sprint simulation of a 158.644. Pete McLaren from Crash.net, we have to thank for crunching those numbers and working out the average lap time of those. And that only is roughly a quarter of a second a lap slower than Jorge Martin and Pecco Bagnaia have been doing, and about another half a ten slower than Fabio Gianantonio. That was this morning's homework, the first sprint simulation complete for Pedro Acosta. And we've seen it in the past, haven't we? He's a fast learner, is Pedro. When he moved up, of course, to the Grand Prix World Championship as a Moto3 rider, podium in his first race and then won the next three, including one from the pit lane. And then, of course, into Moto2, he was immediately a title contender in the eyes of many in his first rookie season, because he was so quick throughout pre-season testing, and quick again at Sepang in his debut test of 2024 on a MotoGP bike. Pedro Acosta is the real deal. I think we've learned that over the course of the last 3 days. Let's turn our attentions to Yamaha then, as we see some more live pictures from the Petronas Sepang International Circuit, as Ducati get ready to cast an eye over what their starter device is able to deliver. Of course, they really did move the game on when that was concerned around about midway through last year. It was around Austria time, wasn't it, where we really saw the effects of that, when Pecco Bagnaia was able to hold off the fast down in KTM of Brad Binder and win both the Tissot sprint and the main race itself. And this is such a crucial part of MotoGP nowadays, along with qualifying, with overtaking so difficult, with the competitiveness of MotoGP nowadays. Perhaps your best opportunity to make up quick ground is at the start of a race. So these are crucial moments for the riders to try and nail down the perfect start. You can see Marc Marquez there lowering his GP23 Ducati, getting ready to launch it off the line, and Andrea Bastianini pulling up alongside him there. Marc Marquez, as we mentioned, we did see signs of some explosive time attack pace from the 93 today. He said a 157.270, which moved him into sixth place on the combined standings, one of five Ducatis inside that top six. But as mentioned, Yamaha is what we're going to turn to next, as Fabio Quartararo, just in the background there, right on cue, pulled into position for his practice start. And I believe we're going to hear from Fabio over the course of the show, as well as his team manager, Mayo Merigali. There is El Diablo leaving the start-finish straight in Sepang. And as we briefly discussed yesterday, Yamaha, I guess, would have been concerned by the complaints that Fabio Quartararo had following his second day. Because, of course, right throughout last season, Yamaha's glaring flaw was a lack of single lap pace in qualifying. Whenever they went for a time attack, they just didn't have the speed to ultimately match the Ducatis, KTMs or Aprilias. No matter how good their race pace was, they couldn't really use it from deep down the grid. Fabio Quartararo would have arrived at Sepang desperate for a solution to that, and it appears he's still waiting.
Yeah, certainly does. From the shakedown, we were getting positive signs from Yamaha, weren't we? Both Fabio and Alex Rins, the newcomer, were both saying, yeah, positive steps have been made in the Yamaha camp. Radiating confidence was Lynn Jarvis as well, saying the package is much better. Again, though, like Honda, they're not expecting miracles at the start of this season. Small gains is what was needed, but seeing Ducati, of course, set the pace they're doing, they need to make strides forward and strides forwards quickly. Fabio has been realistic, but yeah, in the last sort of couple of days, especially Lewis, that time attack pace just hasn't been there. He's been about 8 tenths off the fastest times, which isn't going to cut it in MotoGP, unfortunately. No front row for Fabio at all last year, and he's not had a pole position since 2022. So a year and a half, really, of really, really struggling in qualifying. And as you rightly say, that cost him on a Sunday, especially with just how competitive MotoGP is. But yeah, that is something that they're going to need to find and find quickly. The 2 days in Qatar coming up are going to be crucial to try and find that one, that pace. Fabio said in his interview today that he's confident on Sunday that his pace is up there with the very best of them. Maybe a tenth or two slower than what he wants it to be, but he can sort of find that extra couple of tenths. We know Fabio is one of the best riders on the grid. But yeah, they need to really, really find that one, that pace. He said yesterday, we have no idea where that's going to come from, which doesn't sound promising at all, but hopefully for Yamaha's sake and Quartararo and Rins' sake that they might have found a solution at the end of today. If not, a couple of days in Qatar to find out.
Well, that's the big concern, isn't it? If a rider was saying, we have this problem with the bike, but we know where to fix it, we know where we're going wrong, you'd have a little bit more calmness and confidence that it's all going to right itself. When the rider speaks of, we've got no idea how to fix this, then it doesn't appear to be a quick fix. But we're not going to write Yamaha off by any means. Fabio Quartararo had to go to Q1 12 times last year in a 20-round season, and only one of those 12 occasions did he actually successfully move through to Q2, which underlines how short Yamaha fell last year in terms of single lap pace. For an overall summary on their Sepang test, which of course included 3 days of extra running at the Sepang Shakedown, we caught up with their team manager, Mayo Merigali.
The main three, area which we work for the most, that were the engine, the aerodynamics, and also we introduced a new rear start device. All these items has been confirmed, has been approved from all the riders, from Carl, Fabio and Alex. The bike is a bit faster, the aerodynamics is starting helping the rider to turn. And also the restart device is giving us less wheeling, more acceleration. And now, if I have to point an area where we should improve, for sure is the qualify. It's true that there is still a gap that we have to close. It's true that we will have a lot of time during this season to work hard and make it smaller and smaller. But we are not much worried.
I can hear you now. Yeah.
So Mayo Merigali then giving his summary on the Sepang test for Yamaha, appearing to make progress, but perhaps not ultimately solving all of their problems. They were top of the speed traps yesterday, and for so long we've just been discussing Yamaha's shortcomings in a straight line. It would appear that they're a match for the competition down the straight, but of course over a single lap, which includes many a corner, they're not quite there yet. Let's hear the thoughts then of the 2021 MotoGP World Champion. Here is Fabio Quartararo. He spoke a little bit earlier on.
Fabio, a long time here in Sepang and almost over now. It seems that it's much more positive at Yamaha this year, but we saw you reference yesterday that there's still that one problem of qualifying where you're still struggling.
Yeah, we're still struggling on one lap pace, so hopefully we can make a step forward. That's basically the main goal of the next test and the first few races. So hopefully we can make a step forward and be closer to the top guys, especially on one lap.
Where have you made the biggest improvements? We know that the engine has obviously helped, but where around the circuit has that led to extra lap time?
Well, you know, it's a little bit in general. You know, of course, the engine is better, the aerodynamics are better, but we miss the mechanical grip that I think is the main problem, and the electronics that we are still very far. But with these new people in the team, I think that step by step we are going to be closer and closer to the best manufacturers.
Realistically speaking, what are you looking at now? Say if we were to go racing next week, where would you be looking at in terms of a good result?
More than a good result, my goal right now is trying to make the best qualifying. To be on the first two rows, three maximum, that will be the main goal. Because then on the pace I know I'm pretty fast.
What is it that's holding you back with that qualifying?
Yeah, I think the mechanical grip we have is stopping us a lot, the electronic, and I think that we are pushing way too much on the braking, and I think that is the only point where we can make a little bit of difference.
Thank you, Fabio.
Thank you.
So still work to do then for Yamaha in Qatar in a week and a half time, so they're appearing to make progress in some areas, but still a long way to go. Let's head out to Malaysia then and rejoin Simon Crafar, who's up in the grandstand, we believe, at the Petronas Sepang International Circuit, who was casting an eye just a moment ago over those practice starts. Welcome back, Simon. We can actually put a question from our fans to you. We've been asking for your questions for Simon Crafar on Instagram, and Ivano Ivory asks this question. He asks, will Honda and Yamaha get back on the road to success this year and keep up with the Ducatis? Where on that process do you think they are?
I think the first part of that question, yes, will they be on the road to success? But to keep up with the Ducatis this year, I would say no. That's my gut feeling. The thing is, they have really only had the winter and to work on the improvements, and both of them have taken a big step forward. You know, that interview with Fabio and then before that Mayo Mirigali, they were really honest replies, and they fit exactly with the information I have and my gut feeling, meaning all the areas that have improved that they aimed at, the three lots of parts, but they're still behind in electronics, it seems, and mechanical grip. And the Honda ones, the engine is better, the thing's lighter, they've got more feel, but they also are struggling with rear grip, and I don't think they're going to be able to make up the advantage that Ducati has built up over so many years, especially when they've just moved the goalposts forward again. Just to summarize, no, I'll let you go back to, in case you got more questions there.
Simon, we heard from Fabio there about the one lap pace. How worried do you think Yamaha and Fabio and Rins as well are going to be heading to the Qatar test? Is it sort of time to panic yet, or do they just need to stay calm? And what do you think they need to do to try and get that one lap pace back, which we know is so important these days in MotoGP?
I've been thinking about that, so I'm glad you asked. So as I look at the Yamaha, they have made a good step forward with the engine. Like I said, they've made a good step forward with the aero. They are allowed to keep working on those things during the season. It's part of the concessions. And they will keep working on them. I think electronics is the unknown bit, whether they can improve that. They've been working really hard the last 2 days on that. Both the team and riders are telling me that. What I think is they need about 0.3 in qualifying to be then in the range of a good start position because Fabio's race pace, like last year, is there. So 3 tenths, if they can get that 3 tenths, I think it's doable. I'm only talking about the start of the season. They can continue to close it. I think it's doable because a couple of things. They haven't had long with the new aero package and or everything they've got, like everyone, to adjust the bike to the optimum. I believe the ride height device maybe has more range now. The aero's putting weight in different places. So they need time to make all that work together. And with another test, and they can get a little bit more out of it. Others will too. But one other thing, I'm looking at the Yamaha and a lot of the parts that they've brought here to test, the aero parts, are all prototype stuff made out of quite heavy material. And for the race, they've confirmed it all now, it'll be out of carbon fibre. I'm guessing it'll be 2 kilos lighter, that bike, when they get to the race. And most of the others haven't done that, meaning they are, okay, a couple of KTM parts are the same. But what I'm saying is 3 tenths is doable. And I think if Fabio and Yamaha get that, they're going to be in with a fight, at least from the start.
Yeah, and just to underline your point there, Simon, if you give Fabio Quartararo 0.3 of a second on the lap time he's done today, he would go from 11th up to 6th, which would put him in that sort of second row area where he could compete. Thank you very much for now. We'll join you again later on in the show to put some more of the fans' questions to you, but thanks very much for the moment, Simon. So we'll move on now to Primat Pramac Racing, and one immediate line to bring you, of course, is on Frankie Morbidelli, who, of course, did not take any part in this test in Malaysia. He will also not run at the Qatar test in a week and a half times. Frankie Morbidelli had a crash in private testing on a Ducati Panigale at Portimao last week, coming over the crest of Turn 8, and was knocked out. Now, he was given medical advice to rest up. He'll miss the Qatar test, and therefore, Frankie Morbidelli will not put his leg over a Ducati GP24 until free practice, the very first session on the Friday afternoon in Qatar in around about a month's time. And from Frankie's point of view, given what we were discussing earlier on with Enea Bastianini, who of course missed track time to such an extent last year that his season never really recovered, just how much of a back foot is Frankie on now?
Huge back foot, yeah. Super disappointing for Frankie Morbidelli. We know how big of a year it is to move into Ducati from Yamaha. It's a sort of a dream move for Frankie Morbidelli. He's really struggled the last few years on the Yamaha, as we know. So to get a factory bike in Ducati was a great move for
the
Italian.
There's a great irony with all of that, isn't there, as well? If Frankie Morbidelli was still a Yamaha rider, he could go testing to try and catch up and get himself up to speed. But of course, now he's a Ducati rider with Pramac, can't do that.
Exactly. So his really his pre-season testing starts at the Qatar GP in FP1. He obviously did a few laps in Valencia, but the conditions there weren't very good. Tricky to get used to the bike fully. He was on the 2023 bike as well that Johan Zarco ended the year on. So he's not tried the 2024 packets at all. So the new fairing that Jorge Martin was took a good day to try and work out if it was better or not. Morbidelli's got to do all that at the Qatar GP. So an uphill task for sure for Morbidelli. It's going to take him at least a couple of rounds, you think, to get fully up to speed. Unfortunately, now for Frankie, he's got to do that pretty quickly. So starting the season on the back foot isn't what he wanted, but glad thing is he's relatively okay. Unfortunately, he has got to sit out the tests, but we'll be seeing him in Qatar. Let's just hope he gets up to speed quickly.
Well, let's get the very latest on Frankie Morbidelli. We put that very question to his new team manager. Here's Gino Bossoi.
Of course, I'm in contact with Morbidelli every day because he asked me about the test, but he's okay. He have no big problem. We have to wait the 4 weeks, as the doctor said, and then we will back at the race. It's a really tough moment. Everybody knows it's a really tough moment, not easy to manage because you have to start straight away from the race without any days of test, and which is quite difficult because everybody have on the background the setup and the idea how to start. And we have to start more or less from, not, I cannot say from zero, because we can, let's say, understand what Pecco and Jorge have on the bike and start from there. But, you know, it will be not easy for Morbidelli.
Yeah, not easy, to put it mildly, for Frankie as he adjusts to life on the GP24, which he'll have at his disposal. And as Gino Bossoi alluded to there, he'll be leaning very heavily on the feedback and the information that will be coming from a couple of his very good friends, in fairness, in Pecco Bagnaia and Ea Bastianini as well, his fellow Italian, Jorge Martin, his new teammate. And I guess that's one crumb of comfort that you can give Frankie Morbidelli, is that he's not going to be short of data to pile through, is he?
No, exactly that. 8 Ducatis on the grid in total, so Frankie can look at 7 other Ducatis' data. Okay, the 2023 package isn't the 2024 package, but he's got to try and soak up everything he can. Obviously, being within the VR46 Academy, the likes of Pecco, Bezzecchi can go and offer him some tips and helping hands, but he's on the back foot already. But he's got a great team around him in Prima Pramac. They're going to support him all he can, work really hard over the Qatar GP and over the coming GPs as well. So he's on the back foot, but he's in a good stable to try and make progression, easy for me to say, quickly.
Well, the quickest of them all, certainly from a parent point of view, is Jorge Martin. So quick in the closing stages of last year as he went on that tear to chase down Pecco Bagnaia. Of course, 9 sprint wins last year for Jorge Martin, and of course a quartet of Sunday Grand Prix wins as well, which took the fight for the title down to the very last round. And it appeared through the Sepang test so far as if Jorge Martin wasn't exactly clear in his head whether he liked the new Ducati fairing or not. Is he any closer to an answer? Let's find out. We spoke to him a little bit earlier on.
Jorge, I don't know if you are more happy because of your time attack or because you reconfirmed finally what's the package you are going to have this year.
Yeah, much more about the second thing you said. For sure, doing a 56 was amazing. We were super fast, and was a nice feeling to see 56 on the dashboard. But the most important thing today was to understand exactly which aerodynamics we are going to use in 2024, and we finally understood that the 24 have a bit more potential, so I'm happy about this. I feel a bit more stronger than starting last season, and this is, you know, this was the main goal, and we achieved it.
But overall, Jorge, the new spec from Ducati is fitting your riding style good enough, or you still prefer the behavior of last year's bike?
No, today we reconfirm and we tried again both of them, and I felt a bit faster with the new one. So I'm happy. Yesterday maybe was a bit more difficult. I think you have to get used to it also, because it's a bit different and you have to change a little bit your riding style. But I think it's a bit more stable and it's helping me to go faster. So we will ride with this one.
Yeah, so Jorge Martin would appear to be a little clearer in his head now which direction he's going to go in, which will be positive from his point of view. And he was right up there, wasn't he? When we were looking at the sprint simulations earlier on, our colleague Jack Appleyard was compilating the various runs that were being put together. And until Fabio Di Gianantonio put an impressive sprint simulation in late in the day, Jorge Martins was the class of the field, wasn't it?
Yeah, it really was. And sort of, again, what we expect from Jorge Martin today was going to be interesting. Like he said in that interview, it was all about trying to nail down what fairing he preferred. We know Bastianini and Pecco had already confirmed, yeah, that 2024 fairing, the aero update, is what we prefer. As we've mentioned, he had a tricky time yesterday trying to figure out if that 2024 fairing was better or not. And the good news for Martin and Ducati today is he agrees with Pecco and Ea that fairing has more potential. He's got more pace and he feels better on it. So a good day 3 for Martin. Obviously a great test overall, sort of what we expected coming into the Sepang test. The top 2 in the championship going great guns again with Pecco's teammate Ea Bastianini on the other 2024 spec Ducati right up there as well. So impressive stuff from Martin. Good to hear that he's figured out what direction he wants to go with that fairing. And yeah, the signs are all promising.
Certainly are. Of course, the next circuit that Jorge Martin will ride a lap in anger around will be the Losail International Circuit in Qatar, not just for the pre-season test there, but the first Grand Prix of the season. And you kind of feel that Jorge Martin's got unfinished business with Losail, given the way his championship hopes took a real blow there last year. Of course, the last couple of Qatar Grand Prix have been won by Gresini, although neither of those riders race for the team any longer. It's the Marquez brothers now who make up the Gresini lineup, and we've been sort of wondering, haven't we, over the first couple of days, when are we going to see the first real signs of explosive pace from Marc Marquez? If you look deeper into the lap charts, you can see that the pace is clearly there over longer runs. We saw the first glimmer, didn't we, today, of his pace over a time attack. He's clearly there or thereabouts.
Yeah, he said yesterday, didn't he, that he wasn't prepared to push in the first couple of days. He's working very methodically. I think everyone, including myself and probably as well Lewis, sort of expected him to come into this Sepang test, go straight out, try and blow the competition away, prove, yeah, I'm Marc Márquez, I'm an eight-time world champion. I'm now riding arguably the best bike on the grid, but he's worked away, did the most laps of anyone yesterday, did a sprint simulation today, which was right up there with the best of them, 2-3 tenths off the best, but it's only his fourth day on the Ducati. So, yeah, Marc really impressive. And as you say, finally today, he did try and push in that time attack. Said yesterday, I think it was, he wasn't quite feeling the front end, which we know from down the years, that's a massive, massive strength that Marc Márquez boasts, is his feeling with the front end, how much he can push into the corner. But it's coming. Davide Tardozzi said earlier on in the social live to Jack and Simon that we haven't seen the full potential of Marc Márquez yet. P6 in the overall times, just over half a second off Pecco Bagnaia's unofficial lap record. But for Marc to be under the official lap records is a job well done. And as I say, the amount of laps he did yesterday and the amount of work he's doing on his pace, it's right up there with the best of them. So more to come from Marc for sure.
72 of them yesterday, that's how many laps he put in, and he put in a further 54 today, so just over the course of just over 24 hours, Marc Márquez has done the equivalent of around 6 race distances at the Sepang International Circuit, so he's got plenty of information to pore over before he goes out on track again in Qatar. And of course, Marc Márquez made the point, didn't he, that these are two circuits, Sepang and LaSalle, that notoriously over the past he's not gone particularly well at. They are weak circuits historically for Marc Márquez, so I guess his expectations coming to these tests will have been relatively low. But when the red lights go out for the first Tito sprint in Qatar, are we expecting Marc Márquez to be anywhere other than in that battle at the front?
No, I don't think so. He'll be right up there, and I think the Ducati riders know that, the grid knows that, and Marc knows that as well. We said about Fabio being able to sort of find those little extra tenths that he can over one lap pace. I mean, Marc Márquez can do exactly the same, if not a little bit more. How many times have we seen down the years on an underperforming Honda, when it really, really mattered, Marc Márquez just pulled something out of the bag. And now he's got a package underneath him that's going to make that easier for him. He's going to be right up there in Qatar, that's for sure.
And I think involved in that battle will be his teammate, Alex Márquez, who was part of that 156 club today. Not only would I say I wouldn't be surprised if Alex Márquez isn't in that leading battle in the Tito sprint in the first Grand Prix of the season in Qatar. In fact, I'd be very surprised if he isn't.
Yeah, same here. I think having Marc join him in the garage on one hand is bad news because of how good Marc is, but also it can prove to be a motivation for Alex. Okay, I've got my eight-time world champion brother here, but I'm a two-time world champion in my own right. I've ridden the Ducati for a year, proved I can win a sprint on it and get podiums on it in Sunday races. And like you say, joining the 156 club with the other three riders who are all on the latest spec Ducati. Really, really good job from Alex Márquez. I think we're all expecting big things from Alex Márquez. He said he's happy with his race pace. A few things to iron out. I think the 2023 bike is more different than the 22 bike that a lot of riders were expecting. We heard Bezzecchi saying that in particular, and Pablo Nieto, the VR46 team manager. But yeah, Alex Márquez to set a 156 today in the Sepang test was really, really a job well done.
Yeah, 156.938 for Alex Márquez today to put him in that club, that exclusive club with Bagnaia, Martin and Bastianini. And after setting that lap time, he gave us his thoughts at the end of the Sepang test. Here is Alex.
Hello. Alex, tell me please your evaluation of these 3 days of test in Sepang.
Well, quite happy. I mean, I think we did three really solid days, and this is the most important thing. Making a really serious work and understand the thing, understand the 23 bike. I mean, what I said, we did a really good form. I arrived here physically conditioned in a really good way, and this is so important also. And yeah, we were lucky this morning to go in the club of the 56. That was a nice lap. And especially today we did again a sprint simulation, just to understand with a different setup and different electronic setup also, to understand better the things. We did it, and it's a really good information that we took from here to Qatar.
With this new specification of bike, Alex, do you feel more comfortable with than with the previous one?
Now I get used more to this bike. I mean, it's true what I said always, that in the test it's really difficult to take conclusions, because I mean, the grip level was so high this morning, also this afternoon. So, I mean, you take the conclusions a little bit in a careful way. But I mean, yeah, the work that we did, how we work on the box, the atmosphere on the box was the right one, and this is so important.
Thank you very much, Alex.
Thank you.
So he seems pretty happy, doesn't he? It appears that Alex Marquez has made that adaptation to the GP23, and as we've been discussing, that's not necessarily something you can say for the entirety of the riders who switched from a 22 to a 23 Ducati. It does appear as if Marco Bezzecchi's adaptation has been a little bit more difficult, but Alex Marquez looking good. As mentioned, he was in the top four today. Let's turn our attentions to Aprilia then, who we opened the show with yesterday, with Aleix Espargaró and Maverick Viñales looking relatively competitive. Of course, they caught the eye when the test began with the Batmobile-esque aero on the rear seat of the Aprilia. Any pre-season optimism may have surrounded Aprilia coming into today. I wouldn't say it's all gone, but it might have had a little splash of cold water poured on it.
Yeah, I tend to agree with that. We're going to hear from Rivola very shortly, and he sort of says, look, we've obviously made good progress with the bike, tested a lot of new things on it. The amount of aero they've tried is remarkable, really. So a lot of new things for the riders to get used to. I think Aleix really made that point. It's definitely a step forward. It's more competitive than the 2023 RSGP, but with the amount of things we've got to try, we're taking a little bit more time to get used to it and try and figure out the direction they've got to go in. And Maverick was saying the same. He said jumping on the 23 RSGP, he felt great immediately, which obviously is understandable. He rode that all last year and came close to winning on it on a couple of occasions. But yeah, they found it a little bit difficult, especially Maverick Viñales and Miguel Oliveira, to really home in their sort of feelings on the new bike. Aleix is up there inside the top five, setting just under the 156 barrier, just above, sorry, the 156 barrier. There it is on your screens there. So Aleix managed to get a good lap time in on the time attack, but Maverick was saying on day one and day two, he doesn't feel ready to have a time attack on the new bike yet. And if he has done today, it wasn't really necessarily a great time attack. A couple of tenths under the all-time lap record from Pecco. But yeah, coming into it, we did think Aprilia, okay, they're going to be probably the nearest challengers to Ducati, but as we'll hear from Rivola shortly, they're happy with the progress they've made, but Ducati have made that step forward and Aprilia haven't probably quite made the leap they wanted to so far.
For me, it feels so reminiscent of pre-season testing last year when Aprilia brought what looked on the face of it quite a radical upgrade, because it was a completely new bike that they brought last year. And Aleix Espargaró said at the time it was a small step forward in pretty much every area, but ultimately it wasn't the giant leap forward that he was hoping for. And of course Ducati were able to stretch their advantage in the end over Aprilia, although of course they did take a couple of wins during the summer. So let's get an overview then of what kind of progress Aprilia have made and where they feel they sit in the pecking order. Earlier on, Emilio Vasquez caught up with their CEO Massimo Rivola.
We brought many parts, as you said. We need now to find the best combination for each single rider, and that will be the most important, because at the end is the rider that goes on track, and so we need to get the maximum out of his feeling. So maybe you will see three RSGP24 with different aero setup configuration. It could be, but we are ready to do that. Still, it's a long way. It's a long way to understand really this bike. To be realistic, if we see the step that Ducati did, it's a further step that is really impressive. We see everybody going very fast. The good thing is that the show should be super nice to watch on TV and on track. But I don't think we will be ready to fight with Ducati now.
So I hate to break it to you folks, but Massimo Rivola didn't sound awfully confident there, did he, that Aprilia are going to be in the fight with Ducati, certainly initially. Of course, we do expect more to come from Aprilia in the Qatar test, where we expect their final spec of a 2024 engine to emerge. But as we say, it doesn't appear as if there is an awful lot of optimism. I mean, Aleix Espargaró's outright lap time today was pretty competitive. He was in the low 157s, but ultimately not good enough to match the Ducatis. And we know that Aleix Espargaró and Maverick Viñales, they wear their hearts on their sleeve, don't they? You do wonder as the season unfolds, and we're going to hear from Maverick Viñales shortly, if Aprilia aren't as competitive as they hoped or expected, you do wonder where their tempers may fray down there.
Yeah, a little bit. What I would say is Aleix has already said that this is probably the best testing programme Aprilia have undertaken since he joined Aprilia, which is kudos to what Aprilia have done over the winter. We've seen how many new parts they've brought. And what I would say is you can sort of compare it to KTM last year. The bike's changed a lot visibly and obviously electronically with the settings as well. KTM looked like they were nowhere at the 2023 Sepang tests. Aprilia definitely aren't nowhere and in that sort of position this year. And KTM went on to have a pretty good season themselves. Brad Binder, of course, finishing fourth in the overall standings. So I don't think there's any reason to panic. Rivola saying they're not ready to challenge Ducati is, of course, a little bit of a worry, which is not what we want to hear, not what Aprilia want to hear. But there's signs to be promised. There is promising signs for Aprilia. There's no reason, I don't think, to worry so much at the moment. I think the Qatar test will say a lot about where they are, though.
Yeah, we'll get the what we expect to be essentially the full 2024 spec Aprilia complete with engine at the Qatar test. So I might have more of an idea there as to how competitive ultimately they're going to be. And they're another example of just how fast MotoGP progresses, given that Aleix Espargaró today did a 157 flat, which I think anyone in MotoGP would have absolutely bitten your arm off for in the Grand Prix last year. And even arriving at this test in the end, he's 0.4 of a second off the pace of world champion Pecco Bagnaia. Maverick Viñales was even further back. The number 12 was P12. We'll hear from him shortly, but first we can hear live from another Aprilia rider, this time Miguel Oliveira for the Trackhouse team. Let's hear from him live now in Sepang.
Miguel, just stretching the neck out there. I'm sure maybe the muscles are a little bit sore after the 3 days on track.
Yeah, physically it's a little bit difficult to manage the whole 3 days, but yeah, feeling good actually. It's a good training. The best training is the bike. Just the hands a little bit burned up, but all good.
And the bike itself, initially it seemed like it was going all very well, and then there was maybe a couple of issues. You said yesterday about lack of rear grip. Was that improved today?
Yeah, you know, we tried a couple of things this morning, and we totally lost the good temperature window to do a lap time. Then we carry on with the used tires and just trying to get a little bit more feeling with the stable setting, because we've been changing so much throughout every exit that we found out that was at the moment important, just to get used to the bike and just don't try too many things. Finally, at the end of the day, got me a new set of tires again, but just the rear tire, but couldn't improve anyway. The ideal lap time, it's a little bit more satisfying, but we know how important the timesheet on the test is, you know. So we are not really in panic at the moment, just getting through a couple of things to go to Qatar, ready to work for the first race.
For yourself, of course, it's a two-year step up in machinery, and each year we've heard that the Aprilia has become slightly more physical to ride because of the aero. Did it feel like quite a big jump and a different way to ride the 24?
It is a little bit more heavy, but I wouldn't say that it's something that completely destroys us. I think riding the bike, always the effort should match the lap time, you know. So if you're putting in a lot of effort and the lap time it's coming, then it's all good. The opposite, of course, it's frustrating.
Thank you, Miguel.
Thanks.
Yeah, thanks to Miguel Oliveira. And just to his point in reference to his ideal lap time, his fastest lap time that he did today was a 1:58.000. If you put his best sectors together, he was a good quarter of a second quicker than that. So there is more pace in Miguel Oliveira's pocket. And as he pointed out there, the importance of testing lap times isn't exactly huge. Of course, no points on offer at this stage. That is for Qatar on the second weekend of March. Sticking with Aprilia then, and as promised, let's hear from Maverick Viñales. The number 12 was P12 today, and afterwards, here's what he had to say to us.
Averick, what's the final evaluation of this test of Sepang?
The final evaluation is that I need one more day, at least, here in Sepang. We still don't have the feeling, we don't have the setting, so I'm struggling a lot with the bike. But however, it's a matter of time to work on the balance of the bike to find the correct point. I struggle on the entry of the corner. The bike is very unstable and I'm not able to push. So I'm very pleased with the lap time because I'm not able to push and we already did a considerable good lap time and also on the rhythm. So yes, just step by step, we're going to get closer.
Yeah, you don't want to ever hear a rider using the word unstable to describe a motorcycle, which is what Maverick Viñales used there, but he was still in the mid-157s, and I guess that's the point he's trying to make there, that over the grand scheme of things, to set that kind of lap time with the obvious problems he had, that is no bad thing. Let's turn our attentions then to his teammate, Aleix Espargaró, who was the quickest of the Aprilias today. He was just outside that magic 156 today, but he was the nearest challenger to that leading quartet of Ducatis. Let's find out how Aleix feels at the end of testing here in Malaysia.
Well, Aleix, what's the final evaluation of these 3 days of test here in Sepang?
Yeah, very happy overall, really. I enjoyed quite a lot this first test of the season. Today, I think we did a really good job. I will say that we complete our best test program since I'm in Aprilia here in Sepang. So I'm very happy and proud of the job done by Aprilia in Noale during the winter. The 24 spec bike is promising, looking good. So yeah, can't wait to go to Qatar and keep trying.
We believe you, Aleix, because we were checking the data, the timing, and your sprint simulation was 6 seconds or 7 seconds even faster than last year's one. That's impressive.
Yeah, we did a solid job today, and as Michelin told me, we are the only that we simulate the sprint with the used tire because I didn't have new tires, so I simulate the sprint with the used tires, and even thought I was quite fast. I was able to maintain the 58.4, which is almost our qualifying lap time of last year. So I'm very happy about the improvements.
But even though Massimo Rivola just told us 1 hour ago that Aprilia is not ready to fight the Ducatis and fight for the championship this year, what do you make of that?
Yeah, but he's right. I mean, once again, all Ducatis on top, and I was the only bike in the mix with them. But obviously, we improve a lot. The bike is definitely better than last season ones, but not sure if we are able to fight for the title yet. But in any case, we still have time. It's just the first test of the season. But Massimo is right. They still have the bike to beat. They have many strong riders, so it's not going to be easy.
And finally, Aleix, one of...
So kind of chalk and cheese there, weren't they? The two interviews between Maverick Viñales and Aleix Espargaró. If Maverick's glass was half empty, it seems as if Aleix's is half full, doesn't it?
Yeah, exactly. That may be a bit of experience coming into play with Aleix there. He said himself, as I said before, that that's the best test sort of run they've had since he's been there at Aprilia. Sounding a lot more positive than Maverick. Of course, you want to be P1 or right at the sharp end in the test, but when you're trying so many new things on the bike, it makes it difficult to try and get into a rhythm, as Aleix has been saying all the way through this test. Maverick, of course, disappointed with being outside the top 10 and not being able to sort of maybe go for a full-time attack like he wanted to do. But Maverick also saying that the time when not pushing is coming, and Aleix saying what he's just said there does sound positive. As I said before, no reason to panic at the minute for Aprilia. What Rivola said slightly rings alarm bells, you'd say, but with the amount of stuff they're trying, they're going to refine that down at the Qatar test, you'd imagine. And then by Qatar, you'd think and hope that they're pretty much there. And as Aleix said, to do that sprint sim on used tyres and be right up there within sort of 0.3 of the fastest Ducati, that's impressive.
Yeah, ultimately, there are always sort of stories beneath the surface that are put a little bit more context on the lap times that you ultimately see. And Aleix Espargaró explaining there the story behind his sprint simulation, that it wasn't done on brand new tyres. We're going to stick with Aprilia then and return to Trackhouse. We've already heard from Miguel Oliveira. We heard from Simon Kratochvil earlier on too, discussing Trackhouse. And of course, the big breaking news overnight, which surrounded the man who's now going to be heading the operation there, the new team principal, a very familiar face in MotoGP. Davide Brivio is back, and he will be the team principal of the new Trackhouse Racing squad running those Aprilias this year. We got Simon's view earlier on. Let's discuss it here. In terms of the team itself, which is, of course, it's taken over an existing team, but of course, Trackhouse are new to MotoGP. How big a vote of confidence is it in what they're doing and what they're aiming to achieve in MotoGP that Davide Brivio, who was only recently released from the Trackhouse, from the Alpine Formula One team, is deciding to give them his support? Hold that thought. We'll answer that question because Marc Márquez is waiting to speak to us. So Marc Márquez is waiting to speak to us. We can cross live to Sepang now and hear from the 93.
Marc, thank you for waiting there. Big test. Obviously, there was lots of eyes on your garage watching your outs today. The first thing that struck was the pace in your long runs. Really, really strong. How was it from your side?
Yeah, you know, we work a lot these 3 days, especially step by step. This was the key point. I mean, I never go in on the panic. I never was nervous. I just was working in my garage. I knew that, for example, first day and second day, I was many time on 20 position, 19, 18. But I was super calm, just trying to understand the bike, trying to understand the things. In Valencia, it's true that it was a bit easier. But he, as I expect, was harder to understand, especially because it's a circuit, one of the worst circuits in the calendar for me. For some reason, always I has been slow and in this circuit. But apart of that, the progression was good during the weekend. Already yesterday, the pace was not bad. I did the long run, sprint race simulation, 10 laps. Today, the most positive thing is that I was able to understand a bit better how to take profit from the new tire. And on that time attack, I was able to be faster in the both tires. So this also was important. Still far from the top guys, because half second is a lot, but not bad. Apart of that, I did another sprint simulation that has been good, but you know, you need to understand the time you did, the time the others did. For example, some riders, they did with a lot of track temperature, that means that you are slower. Another riders did at 11:30, 12, another riders at 5. So yeah, but the most important for me is that the feeling was good.
How do you feel on the bike now? Because we've seen each day that you're saying, oh, you're slightly looser on the bike and not feeling so tight. How was it today?
Yeah, this afternoon, especially on the race simulation or the sprint race simulation, was not on the plan. But I say to them, I want to try to play with the bike, try to change lines, try to understand with the gas, try to be more free. And to be more free, I mean, you need laps. And yeah, I was super tired, but even like this, I say I want to do, even if I'm slower. But it's the way to improve. I mean, stay in the garage, you will never improve. So yeah, I just keep going, keep riding, laps, and yeah, I mean, I will insist more in the future to try to keep that progression. Will be not easy, because it's true that with Honda, for example, in 2 runs I was already in the limit. This one takes more time to understand.
What do you expect going to the Qatar test? Obviously another unknown, a new track for you on the Ducati. How do you think you'll gel with that circuit?
Yeah, let's see. Will be another interesting point for me, Qatar test, because it's another circuit that only I won one time or never. I think with MotoGP or one time, I don't know. Also, it's a circuit that I struggle a bit. So we are 2 good circuits, because for example in Valencia was good, but it's a good circuit for me. So the way to learn how to improve is in this kind of circuits that I'm struggling.
Thank you, Marc.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was once, Marc, we can confirm to you, 2014, where he won pretty much everywhere in the first half of that season, but he hasn't won there since. Very quickly then, we were discussing Davide Brivio. Before we move on to KTM, who, as you can see, we're about to chat about, we were about to give our thoughts on Davide Brivio. Just a huge vote of confidence for Trackhouse, that, isn't it? That someone with such proven pedigree in MotoGP is prepared to join them and lead their team.
Yeah, I think if you're going to handpick anyone who was available on the market to come and be your team manager, Davide Brivio probably tops that pile, a title-winning manager, team manager, multiple title-winning team manager with Rossi, Lorenzo and Joan Mir, of course, with Suzuki. So a brilliant coup by Trackhouse to get Davide Brivio on board and lure him away from Formula One, of course. A brilliant signing. a statement of intent as well for Trackhouse. We've mentioned that they're not here to make up the numbers, they're here to win. So a brilliant signing and great to have Davide back in the paddock.
Very quickly, KTM, looking at their testing so far, of course, of their quartet of riders, they're almost the opposite ends of the scale, aren't they? Pedro Costa and Brad Binder have been in the mix. Jack Miller, under the radar, of course, as they work to a program, and Augusto Fernandez really struggling. Overall, KTM, do we get the hunch that they're perhaps the likeliest to maybe give Ducati a hard time?
I'd say so far, yeah, because if you think back to this time last year, all the signs were they're absolutely nowhere, a good 9 tenths off over one lap, whereas Binder and all of them, apart from Augusto, really are happy with the progress they've been made. Miller testing a lot of new items. He's been sort of the testing mule after Pol Espargaró and Dani Pedrosa towards into the official tests. Miller's been putting in the hard graft, as have all of them, but Miller's really been the one who's been first trying all the parts. Binder, of course, as well. And Pedro Acosta, we already can see what he potentially can do. But two of them inside the top 10 in Binder and Acosta. KTM looking strong.
Well, we can bring Simon Crafar into the discussion now regarding KTM, because Simon is ready to chat to us for the final time from Malaysia before he goes and has a hard-earned drink and flies home. And it looks like he's got his fan club with him there in the grandstand out there in Sepang. Hope you can hear us, Simon, over your adoring public. But we've got a couple of questions from the fans to put your way. Creative Franco has the first question. He wants to know, will KTM fight for the title this year? What do you reckon? Do you think they're ready?
You know what? I'm glad I got asked that one, because I was listening that KTM were coming up in the discussions, you know, on the show, and the new engine is fast. I mean, I think it's a match for anything. They've got new electronics. They've made a step forward. I think they've made a step forward in a lot of areas. Ducati have moved the goalposts, but I believe that they are the closest again to Ducati. So, I mean, we know what Brad did last year. So, yes, I believe that they'll be in the mix. I really do.
We've got another question from social media, Simon, about Pedro Acosta from Tahomas too. How promising does Pedro Acosta's debut look? And what are your thoughts on him? I know we've touched on him already, but just how impressive has Acosta been?
I still believe that we should play it down, because and I've been doing my best to all of winter, you know, from when he signed, you know, confirmed that he was coming in here, because to race is not the same as to test. But I've got to admit, although I'm trying to play it down, what he's done here is blown me away. From the very first day on track till today, he's looked like he rode last year, and almost nobody does that. It's quite amazing. Like his feedback, you know, from what I've spoken to mechanics, is really accurate. How he's ridden on track, we're talking about Pedro Acosta, is again blowing me away. Like incredible. I'd just like to say, though, please don't put any more pressure on him. Remember that Pecco turned up here to his first test and was second fastest, but still took a while to figure out how to race these things, and you know, before he became a proper title contender and winner. So give him a bit of time, but he's genuinely astounded me so far.
Yeah, I think he's astounded all of us and impressed all of us. Well, thank you very much for all of your contributions over the course of the Sepang test, Simon. Safe trip home, and we'll leave you to sign some autographs and take some selfies over there out in Sepang. Thanks very much for joining us.
Bye for now.
Thanks, Simon. We'll catch up with him again in Qatar in a couple of weeks. We'll leave him there with his adoring public. And before we go, one more word on Pedro Acosta. For me, he's in many respects the story of this Sepang test. In terms of the way the competitive order lies, Ducati are still incredibly quick. Aprilia and KTM, of course, looking to try and lead the chasing pack. It feels like Honda and Yamaha have made progress, but Pedro Acosta, so far, and as Simon points out, there are going to be many, many hurdles thrown in Pedro Acosta's way over the course of his rookie season. But every question he's been asked so far, he's come up with an answer.
Yeah, I'm trying my very hardest not to get too excited about Acosta, but it's hard not to with the pace he's shown at the Sepang test. Simon is right, of course. Testing's one thing, racing is another, but you just get that sense, the way he's speaking to his team, the way he's speaking in interviews as well, the way he's in the garage. Jack and Simon both reporting that as soon as he's done his sort of technical analysis, he's laughing and joking in the box. So he's a supremely confident character, as we know. And look, it looks like he's going to come out the blocks in MotoGP all guns blazing. And I wouldn't bet against him sort of challenging for the podium and the top six in Qatar. But maybe take a step down from that, as Simon says. Testing is one thing, but hey, look, he's been super, super impressive over these 6 days in Sepang. Who knows what he can do in Qatar?
Well, let's just mark a card of what's to come over the next week and a half or so before we're back out on track again. Next week, we have four team presentations to bring you, starting on Monday, Red Bull KTM Factory Racing. That is Monday, the 12th of February. 24 hours later, we cross over to Madrid. Repsol Honda with Juan Mir and Luca Marini will unveil their new 2024 colours. A couple of days later, LCR Honda will launch their team for the year. Of course, the Castrol and Idemitsu liveries for Jean Zarco and Takanakagami, respectively. And then next Sunday, on the eve of the Qatar test, it's the Aprilia Racing team presentation. Jack Appleyard will be presenting all four of those, and we'll have our journalists and our team on the ground as well to sample the atmosphere from those team presentations. And a week on Monday, the 19th of February, Monday and Tuesday, we'll be bringing you the two-day Qatar test. All the usual coverage. Live timing will be available on MotoGP.com. We'll have the midday updates with Jack Gorston, Simon Crafer, and myself, and Elliot York. We'll bring you after the flag, 30 minutes before the checkered flag comes out under the lights in LaSalle, as we get set for the final pre-season test of 2021. My thanks to Elliot, to Jack, and to Simon, and to all of you for watching, and we'll see you for the Qatar test in a week and a half's time.